Every week, Jihad Watch with Robert Spencer, and people seem to not enjoy, that's the wrong word, but appreciate that I have this segment each week. And for those of you who say, oh, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do this, well, yeah, we have to do this. What is the point? I mean, I can bore you with an interview with some bubble-headed celebrity, or who was on Survivor or Big Brother? Does that exist? I don't know. We need to know what is going on in the world. And before we introduce Robert Spencer, let me just read something to you. Now, I should warn you, this is very graphic stuff. And it's horrible, actually, because it concerns a young, a 15-year-old. I've got a 15-year-old daughter. We have four children. The youngest is 15. Kriss Donald, he was just walking along the street in Scotland, in Glasgow, and he was kidnapped by, and let's be quite specific, a Muslim gang, three men. He screamed, "Why me? Why me? I'm only 15. They then murdered him, but they tortured him. They repeatedly tortured him. They stabbed him 13 times. They then set him on fire while he was still alive. There are other reports that claim that he was castrated. We're not sure of that. He was certainly repeatedly tortured. When his body was found, the person who found it thought it was the body of a carcass of an animal for not being Muslim. Now, eventually, the killers were brought to justice. And the reason we're talking about this now, because this happened back in 2004, was that the man who led this gang, who showed no contrition or apology, Imran Baldi Shahid, there was an attempt to kill him last night in the gym. He's a very big guy, a lot of weight training and so on, and has some enforcers around him. I know, you think they'd live in shame, but no, in the prison. He had special privileges. And there was an attempt to kill him. And it failed. But he's in hospital, getting the best of medical attention in the British system. This is probably the most revolting and intense of the attacks that have taken place, but it is by no means unique. Robert Spencer joins us now by Skype. We can't tell you where he is. That's always a way, because other people will try to kill him. Robert, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Michael.
I mean, this is horribly disturbing. This young man, his parents will never see him grow up. This has to be emphasized. This wasn't about race, which would be absolutely wrong, of course, but it wasn't about black and white. This was a Muslim gang who wanted to kidnap and murder a non-Muslim. Can we please state this quite clearly?
Well, we can, and we do, and we have to, because it's true. But of course, most of the mainstream media, when they reported on this incident way back when it first happened, and now when they're reporting on the attack on Imran Shahid, have characterized it as a racial incident. And it most certainly is not. I mean, there are many attacks like this, and they're increasing in frequency all around Europe. I can give you, for example, Ilan Halimi, who was brutally tortured over a period of weeks by a Muslim gang in Paris. And they had kidnapped and tortured him because he was Jewish. And they even called up his family and recited verses from the Quran to them while they were torturing this people and with torturing Ilan Halimi, that is, with unimaginable brutality.
Yeah.
And clearly situating their actions in the fact that they were Muslims and he was a Jew.
Yeah.
And Kriss Donald, it's the same thing. He was not a Muslim, they were Muslims, and these kinds of attacks increasing in frequency are gestures of supremacism, of intimidation, of a signal to the non-Muslim community that they are not to be crossed in any way, and if they are, this is the kind of thing that will happen.
Mm-hmm. Now, we always say this, we don't have to, but some people get very angry if we don't. This is not to say that the majority of Muslims act like this. Of course they don't. The MP in the area in Glasgow, I think we've got a photograph of him now. He's a Muslim man, a very, very moderate Muslim. Can we see a picture of him, please? There he is. Now, I mean, this man, Mohammed Sawa, an MP, he worked very hard to make sure that the men who committed this terrible murder were brought to justice, because a couple of them have fled the country. But what we have to say is, when he did this, he was then threatened within the Islamic community in Glasgow, and other Muslims attacked him and said he was a traitor.
Yes. Doesn't surprise me in the least. Because it's a very deeply ingrained Islamic principle that one never takes sides with the kuffar, the unbelievers, against the Muslims. Never. Under any circumstances. And so even if you have an action like this, of this horror that is distasteful to you. You don't speak out because it was Muslims who did it. And, you know, I've heard so many stories about this. I'm acquainted with an American who converted to Islam to marry a Muslim woman, and he became, he didn't know anything about Islam, he just was doing it for the marriage. Mm-hmm. But he became active in the Malaysian Muslim community, because his wife was Malaysian, in Florida. And what happened was, after 9/11, they were having a meeting at the mosque, and he thought that they would be all upset and would be condemning what happened on 9/11, but they were all talking about how they had to hang together, and never a word of condemnation of the hijackings. Now, even if there had been somebody there, in addition to the gentleman who was telling me this story, who had disapproved of the hijacking and the mass murder that happened on that day in the name of jihad and Islam, he would have been intimidated into silence, because the community was determined to close ranks and to protect the Muslim.
Mm-hmm. Just very briefly, one more subject. I wanted to spend some time on that because it is so horrific. But there is an allegation the next head of the CIA will be a man who converted to Islam in Saudi Arabia. Is this true?
Well, I don't know if it's true directly, but I know that the source of it is a former FBI agent, John Guandolo, who's a good friend and who I believe to be an unimpeachable source. And certainly it would make sense of John Brennan's actions in carrying water for the Muslim Brotherhood program of whitewashing Islam and jihad, and trying to distance the actions of Islamic jihadis from the very thing that they point to as what motivates them and what their goals are. And so he's carrying water for the Muslim Brotherhood agenda. It would certainly make a lot more sense for him to be doing that if he is, of course, signed on and is a believer himself. Certainly, John Brennan has been an incredible enabler of Muslim Brotherhood influence at the highest levels of government. And so Mr. Guandolo's allegations don't surprise me in the least.
If it is true, and I'm not in any way claiming it is, I know I've seen the reports, but if it is true, would it be an issue? Because you know what will happen. People will say, well, so what if he's a Muslim? He's an American, and his faith is private. It's up to him. So if it were to be proven, and I think that'll be difficult, would it prevent him from being the most powerful intelligence agent in, well, arguably the world?
No, I don't think so at all. There are already quite a few CIA desk chiefs, bureau chiefs who are already converts to Islam. There's a concerted effort by the Saudis and others to convert them. And yes, immediately, if anybody raises any protest about this nomination on those grounds, people would say, well, you can't say that. It's just bigotry and Islamophobia and hate. And the Muslim Brotherhood influence, the Muslim Brotherhood stated agenda in its own words of eliminating and destroying Western civilization from within, none of those things would be discussed.
There's a lot more to discuss, but we've run out of time. There are so many subjects. I wish there were none to discuss. I really do. But I've said before, that's not going to happen in the near future. As always, Robert, thank you so very much.
Thank you, Michael.